Welcome and thank you for joining us today. I trust you are all well, keeping well. My name is Pedro Rodriguez and I'm the events manager at World Sailing. Today I'm joined by Massimo Dinghi, parasailing manager, and today's session is the match racing committee subcommittee and will be held from 11 to 14 UTC. It is pleasing to see you all here, and we are joined by a good number of observers. This session will be recorded and will be available to the public to view within 24 hours of the meeting's conclusions. Blue Jeans meetings. As we have mentioned in various communications, today we are using Blue Jeans meetings. Today's session is being recorded by me via the Blue Jeans meeting system. And I ask you not to record this call yourself. In advance of the call, we supply the house rules document and the document outlining how to use Blue Jeans meetings. I encourage you to use the chat function to engage with the session. Two options of chat are available. The first one is the open chat where everyone can see your comments, and secondly, we have the chat with moderator whereby you can engage directly with me. We encourage you all to see the chat function to highlight your wish to speak on a topic or ask a question. I also ask everyone to take the sound off your telephones, especially for the WhatsApp messages. This is through our experience in previous meetings. I ask all the committee members to keep their audio muted and video on. Committee members. In collaboration with myself and the committee chair, we will hand the floor to speakers and unmute your audio for you. Observers are present in this call and I ask that your microphone and video remain off at all times. The committee chair may open the floor to observers for comments and questions. However, this remains at their discretion. Commentary should first of all come into the chat, and if the chair wishes to hand to an observer, we will unmute your audio and video. If an observer interferes with the meeting, either intentionally or unintentionally, they will be removed from the meeting. You should all be able to see the list of attendees with Blue Jeans meeting system on the right hand side. That's all for me. That concludes my introduction. I will now hand over to the chair. Please.
Oh, thank you, Pedro. Yep, I just needed to unmute. Thank you, Pedro, for all the organization and getting the meeting ready. And thank you to all the staff members who are supporting us here and have supported us from behind the scenes for setting up this meeting. Welcome to the Match Racing Subcommittee virtual meeting for the 2020 annual conference. It's strange not to be together, but it's good to be together in this forum and working together. Again, thank you to all the World Sailing staff for all the work they've done getting this meeting together, but also all the work they've done, especially over the last 8 months during the difficult times when they've been furloughed or their other staff have been furloughed, and it's been difficult to get all the work done. But again, thank you so much for all the hard work. And let's see, a little bit on the ground rules that Pedro went over. This meeting should be last 3 hours. We'll try to take a break about an hour and a half in, a quick 5 minute break to grab coffee for those of us who are up at 4 o'clock in the morning and for others who just need a break. Let's see, Pedro, has David joined us? Pedro Massimo, has David joined us?
It doesn't appear so. No, I can't see David yet.
Okay. We should be joined at some point by the CEO of World Sailing, David Graham, and also by the Vice President responsible for match racing, Jan Dawson. I think neither of them are here yet, but I'll give them a chance to say a few words later when they arrive. Let's see. And so welcome to the committee members, and then also to all of the observers. So let's get right into the agenda for the welcome from me. I'm looking forward to getting quite a bit done this morning, this afternoon, this evening, and go over. We've all received a number of reports, and we'll gladly share some of those points from those reports as we go through each agenda item with the observers. Let's see. So apologies for absence. I received an apology from Russell Green. He had an accident recently and is recovering. And given that it's midnight in Auckland, he wasn't sure he was going to be able to make it for the meeting, but he's sent me some notes for some of the agenda items he's involved with. And we had thought Sungchul Jung was going to join us, but it doesn't appear he's made it, so hopefully he'll be coming on later. It's, I think, 2 o'clock in the morning in Korea, so that might be part of the difficulty there. But aside from that, the other committee members are here, I see. We see the Vice Chair, Michael Rolick, Michael O'Connor, Jana. Good. Let's see, go to the next agenda item, declaration of conflicts of interest. Do we have anyone on the committee, on the subcommittee, who would like to declare a conflict of interest? Ah, it looks like Sungchul just joined us. Welcome, Sungchul. I hope all is well in the middle of the night. So I have not heard any conflicts of interest, so we will note no conflicts of interest. Let's see, the next agenda item, the minutes of the previous meeting. Those were approved after our last meeting, and here they are on the screen. I sent them out in the committee packets yesterday. Do we have anything arising from those minutes that any of the committee members would like to add to our agenda for today? The tough thing about the audio and video turned off in this situation is you can't look around the room and see, so silence is agreement, so this is good. Okay, so back to our agenda. So as we move along on the agenda, I may move a few things around. So I'm going to do that with these first couple of items. We have the agenda item 3 and agenda item 5. So yes, Pedro, to your question. I would like to put those together because of it'll be obvious when I put them together. And a few other items along the way we will put together. So agenda item 3 and 5, so the Women's Match Racing World Championships, an update from the chair, that would be The 2020 Women's Match Racing World Championships were to be held in Auckland next week at the Royal New Zealand Yacht Squadron. Due to the COVID pandemic, they were canceled. Asked if they could host the 2021 Women's Match Race World Championships. And we went to the board with that, and since we had not yet awarded the 2021 Women's Match Race World Championships and had been receiving bids but had not awarded the championship, it was agreed that the 2021 Women's Match Race World Championships would be awarded to the Royal New Zealand Yacht Squadron. And the dates, the same dates, but in 2021. And we have with us on the call Laurie Jury from the Royal New Zealand Yacht Squadron. And I would also ask Pedro to give us, for agenda item 5, a progress report for the 2021 event. And then I'll ask Laurie if he would like to make any comments after Pedro makes his comments.
So regarding the 2021 Youth Match Racing World Championships.
Let's do 2021 Women's Match Racing.
The 2021, of course. So we are in the process of producing the contract, I believe. I think that's what the organizers are expecting. We have agreed with the change of the year of the organization, but I trust Laurie want to give us a real report of how it's going the organization on their side. And we open the mic to Laurie and video.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, from the Yacht Squadron, we're very excited to run the 2021 World Championships, and we're just working with World Sailing on the contract and notice of race.
Perfect. Thank you. Hopefully that should move along. I know we have the situation at World Sailing, where we'll be having some more furloughs, so hopefully we'll be able to get this process quickly before much is locked down. And we'll stay on board with you because you'll come right back and talk to us about the 2020 Youth Match Racing Worlds in a moment. So don't go too far. Not time for bed yet.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, Pedro, if I could have the agenda back.
Sorry.
That's okay. So for the 2020 Youth Match Racing Worlds were held, one of the few events on the match racing calendar, on the international match racing calendar, that was held just prior to the pandemic shutdowns. So in February 2020, actually, what I will ask the World Sailing Technical Delegate for the 2020 Youth Match Racing Worlds. Pedro, that was you, wasn't it?
No. The 2020. No.
Oh, I'm sorry, it was Michael.
No.
Okay, Michael Rolick, can you help me with this? Who are we receiving a report from, or should we get the report from you? Not getting any audio from Michael.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, great. So I think that actually the World Sailing Technical Delegate for the youth was Anne Maledan from France.
Yes, I agree.
And the question is, have you received a report from her?
Well, I'm not sure if I receive a report. Just give me 2 minutes and I will look.
But I can just say a couple of words about it. It was actually February to March 2020, Elliott's 7 boats, crew 4 to 5, and 9 M&As participated, 12 teams, and the winner was James Hodgson from Australia.
Great, thank you, Michael. While Pedro is looking to see if we have a report from Anne, we go back to Lori Drury. And from the host perspective, any comments?
Not too much. I mean, we thought it was a really successful regatta. We got through the full format, great race management team on board, great umpires invited, and did a fantastic job. And, you know, we're just excited to host the World Championships. So, from the host perspective, we thought it all went really smoothly and we're really happy with the result.
Great, thank you. All the reports I heard, and also all the video and the other chats I saw, looked like it was a great event. Lots of great racing and lots of good fun had by all. So I look forward to the similar event, and it'll be fairly easy to make the event the next time for the women with having the experience of having just run it, and just need to hope that the lockdown doesn't cause any problems for us.
Yeah, that's always an issue, especially in New Zealand at the moment with immigration is a big issue for us, as everyone's probably aware. So hopefully that looks quite different in November next year.
Great. Pedro, did you find anything?
No, actually not. Sometimes the reports from technical delegates, they come through the race officials system and technical delegates, and I'm not finding it, but if I have, I will circulate after the meeting for everyone.
Okay, yeah, I think it might have gone. I vaguely remember something from back in the early pandemic days, so I think that might have been part of the fog related to that. Michael Rolick wanted to bring up that the OA provided a clinic and coaching on the water so ahead of the event, and I think that was very well appreciated. And I believe, as we'll discuss later with the youth match racing reports, we'll discuss some of the recommendations going forward and based on past experience from that event. Oh, great, thank you. So 2020, let's see. Now we'll move on to agenda item 6, the 2021 Youth Match Racing World Championships. So we'll get a progress report from the World Sailing Events Manager.
Yes, so the championship is awarded, and I'm a little bit lost here. It was awarded to maybe Michael can help me here.
Yes, it was for the USA and Balboa Yacht Club, Newport Beach, California, the host.
Thank you, Michael. It's just because I'm dealing with all the events at the same time and I missed the years. But
no worries.
All of them are in the same position, so they were awarded, and we are just preparing the documents, I mean the contract, to finalize everything and to make the proper announcements and calendar, etc. But the contacts between ourselves and the bidders or the organizers now, it's smooth, and we look forward for a great championships. And yeah, that's the situation at the moment. Thank you.
Great. I think while we're on the Youth Match Racing World Championships, why don't we actually cover part of agenda item 8 at this time, which is progress report on the other two 2022 and 2023 that have also been awarded for the youth. We'll talk about the youth right now. So Michael Rolick, would you like to carry that and discuss the other two bids that have been accepted?
Yes, thank you. So I put it in the chat also. We had actually in total six bids for 3 years, the 21, 22, and 23. And for the 22, we had France with the Club Nautique APCC in Pornichet, who was the winner of 22, the bid. And one thing that might be of interest is also that the Youth Match Racing World Championship was born with a small discussion with Henry Menin, and I think it was a Frenchman. I don't remember his name at the moment, but in the village of Pornichet. So that was the kind of the starting of the event and the idea also. Then in 23, it's Australia Cruising Yacht Club of Australia and Rush Cutters Bay and Sydney, who is 40. Thank you, Gerard Boss, exactly. And it's we have very, very strong organizers and are very happy to move the championship around.
Great, yeah, so we'll be, we were in New Zealand in 2020, United States 2021, France in 2022, and Australia in 2023. So great to see such good movement of the event, and as Michael said, all very strong bidders and very strong hosts for each of those events. So very much looking forward to seeing how those progress and working and having the office work quickly to get the contracts stabilized, settled and stabilized so that we can move forward again with notices of race and appointments of technical delegates as well as race officials. So great, good work to the bid committee, to the office for organizing the bids, and then also to the working party that Michael Rolick led to evaluate those bids and do it in a timely manner during the pandemic time. So thank you for that. So now stepping back to agenda item 7, which is the Nations Cup. And we have a report from the Nations Cup Working Party led by Michael O'Connor. And then we will discuss from that. I believe everyone on the committee should have read it, but let's put it up and let Michael present this and also the future plans so that the observers may also take part. So Michael O'Connor.
Yes, greetings everybody, especially my subcommittee team members. This is windswept Ireland. We're flooded. We have gale force winds and we have very high tides. So, but life is moving on whilst lockdown may happen. Nations Cup, the last grand final was 2019 in California in St. Francis Yacht Club. Very, very successful. We've got the initial workings of that sorted now, I think. We had 37 entries from M&A, so it's about nations and not skippers. So invitations are sent out to nations, M&As then put in their skippers for selection. The selection is by continent, so we had all six continents represented. We have 19 teams eventually participating, 20 was the limit, and we had 10 boats. And it was very successfully run over 5 days in St. Francis Yacht Club, and the club participation in it was enormous. There was 27 families offered to put up race officials and teams, and look after them for the week. And the club obviously provided the refreshment and et cetera, et cetera. So this meant the event was quite economic to run in what is a very expensive place. So we took the key learnings from that was to essentially to replicate its success, make it easier to attract M&As and skippers, to encourage top teams. So the M&A will present some of its top teams rather than the professionals. And then we would use the match race ranking list in order to actually select who was going to participate in the event. And so every member of the team had to be a national of the country, as in the Olympics. So it's a slightly different type of event to others out there. So in 2019 in Bermuda, the decision was taken to roll it forward for the same format for the next edition. And so this is what we've been working on since. So the bid process was going to follow the bid process for the World Sailing World Championships, youth and women's, and it was going to kick out in March. Unfortunately, COVID got in the way, so we put it on hold for that time, but we have the documents and everything prepared, and that is now to go in the period from November to January and be launched. And with a lot of social media, and then the plan then is bids back by March for final decision to the board of World Sailing in April time. This would then allow 2021 to be the period for signing contracts with the location that's selected to run the event. And that will take a little bit of time. And then by this time next year, next September, October, to have an agreed contract signed under which the notice of race can be issued. And therefore, in the period from next October to December, and using the World Sailing Conference, whether it's online or whether it's physical, to actually be the call to action to M&As to submit teams for the event. That would run in 2022 from either a date of February to late 2022, sort of October, November, depending on the continent, depending on the location, depending on the club that is running it. So that's our position at the moment. And so with COVID aside, we will move forward. I think people now are working well in that environment, and so a lot of the documents are in place. So we just have to go through the social media channels, the marketing, the networks that we have, the enormous help between Pedro and Madeline in the data access to the databases, all the graded events, all the results, which skipper won what, over the previous few years. And so we can actually build quite a profile of match racing in the world, and from that select out equal to the continents to give the emerging continents, the emerging countries opportunities to put in teams, and to also allow the interest. So there was oversubscription in the 2019 edition. We had 37 requests for known named teams to enter. We had only 20 places, so we had to make a selection and leave some behind. Unfortunately, some of those skippers were very, very high level, which was very interesting. But also it allowed time for the younger skippers to come along also, because we did apply within that 20 team limit wildcards for upcoming youth or upcoming women. And so we're looking forward to the next period. And we have a formula that works, and I believe that it can grow match racing and therefore produce skippers and teams that can roll forward into the World Match Race Tour and the America's Cup, and therefore continue with the history of the Nations Cup, which is now 29 years old this year. And in fact, one of the panelists on our call today, Laurie Jury, is a former winner of Nations Cup. So congratulations, Laurie. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Michael. So I would like to open it up to any of the Match Race subcommittee members. Any questions or discussion on the thoughts on moving forward with this. And then if there are any observers would like to say anything after that. So any of the subcommittee members have any thoughts they would like to add to Michael's report? I'll look at your faces if I can. Okay. Doesn't look like there's anything. I think that the last year's edition was a very successful model, and we would definitely move forward with that and hopefully have more reach to some of the developing nations or developing match racing nations in this situation. The Nations Cup should be a good way to do that. It was a very good event with very high level competition, as Michael noted. The thought of being able to bring in access to the World Match Racing Tour and see if we can use some, share some resources there in that situation. So let's see. Do I have anyone from any of the observers have anything they'd like to say on this? Pedro says you can raise your hands if you have something to say. I haven't seen that function used yet. Okay.
Liz?
Yes.
Michael. Just one comment. There was only in the 2019 edition, which you were there for, there was only one team with a coach, which is kind of interesting. So I think one of the ways, and I think Michael in some of his discussion, some of his report on youth match racing, was to consider then with the younger teams or the emerging teams, is to have a coach at large and to have maybe a clinic beforehand, which people can enter or choose not to enter, but it's available to all participants. And to do that, especially at the very early stage of the event, and start building the knowledge sharing as part of the whole thing.
Yeah, that's a great suggestion. And the model of having a coach at large and the clinic ahead of time, as with in the youth, is a good way to do that. I think that is something, especially for the and as it was, we had some teams coming from the Southern Hemisphere to the event who didn't have as much opportunity to sail coming to an event in the Northern Hemisphere springtime in this last edition, and coming from a developing match racing country like South Africa, for example. And you've seen in the chat that James Pleasance saying that the World Match Racing Tour would be happy to help support the Nations Cup in any way they can. So I think we can tap into that resource. And thank you, James. Let's see, before we move on, Pedro had said that David would be joining us, has not quite joined us, but I see that Jan Dawson, our vice president from New Zealand, has joined us late in the evening again. Jan, would you like to make any comments? I know you can't stay with us very long. Would you like to make any comments to the subcommittee? And welcome.
Thanks, Liz. Sorry, I was a little bit late dialing in. Not really any comments to make. There hasn't been a lot of discussion about match racing this year at the board level, because obviously there hasn't been exactly a lot of things happening, but I'm sure that there will certainly be regattas starting up again as soon as we can. So nothing really to add, Liz, but happy to be here.
Great, thank you, Jan. You're in the country where you've seen the last international championship, and now you have a little thing coming up at the end of the year. But hopefully we'll all get to join in, as you said.
Indeed, and early next year.
Yes, early next year. Joined by David Graham, the CEO of World Sailing. So David, welcome to the meeting, and I'd like to give you the opportunity to say a few words now. Hopefully. David, are you there? Okay. David Graham. David, I'm not hearing you. I'm not sure if you are trying to say something or...
Liz, maybe it's another David. I'm just not sure.
Ah, okay.
But, okay, keep going. We'll see if it comes.
Okay.
Thanks.
Maybe that was... okay. All right, so let's move on to the next agenda item. So the next agenda item, coming back to agenda item 8, and we've already heard about the 2021, 22, and 23 Youth Match Racing World Championships. So I will give you the update on where we are in the bid process for the Women's Match Race World Championships. When the, when the 2020 Women's Match Race World Championships were canceled, we entertained, as I said earlier, the request from the Royal New Zealand Yacht Squadron to host the 2021 events. At the time, we had already received bids from three countries, I think we had four at the time, who wanted to bid for the 2021, 22, or 23 Women's Match Race World Championships. And we then received the request from the Royal New Zealand Yacht Squadron to host a 2021. During all this COVID restrictions, it took a little while for the process to go through. And we then had the board approve awarding the host contract to the Royal New Zealand Yacht Squadron for 2021. So then we had to go back to the bidders who had bid for 21, 22, and 23 and ask if they were willing to push their bids back to 22, 23, and 24. One of the bids was from a host that received one of the bid, received the awarding of a bid for the Youth Match Racing World Championships. So they withdrew their bid for the Women's Match Race World Championships. And then one of the bidders said they would be happy to do 22, 23, or 24. And then the third bidder, we're still in discussions with as to whether they would like to push their bid back. They had originally hoped to bid only for 2021. So as it stands right now, we have a bid panel set up to review the bids, but we're again waiting one more small piece to see whether there even needs to be a review or if there's one bid for 2022. So as I'm hoping to sort this out in the next few weeks and then bring it back to the office and then also bring it up with the bidders. I know we have at least one of those bidders on the call today as an observer. So to you, I would say, be patient with us and we hope to have a decision soon that we can take to the board and then take back to the possible hosts. But regardless of that, we will, and if there's only two bids for the 2 years, 22 and 23, we will be obviously going out for bid again for the, for 2024. So that's really it. That's, I know that didn't sound like the clearest explanation, but it's been a long process trying to sort through the bids in this time of lockdown and communications with the Yacht Club people being furloughed as well as some of our staff. So that's all I have for the current bids. Any questions from the committee members? And or any questions from the observers?
No raised hands.
No raised hands, great. Okay, so let's move on to the next item. David, thank you. Okay, so now we have another, there's a David and a David Graham. Now I see that we have David Graham on board, the CEO of World Sailing. And David, I'd like to invite you to make any comments to the Mattray subcommittee. Thank you.
Hi, Liz. How lovely to see you again. How are you doing?
Doing well. It's early in the morning here, but I'm struggling through it.
Yeah. Well, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to all of you. I hope you're all doing well. It's a real shame that we're not able to meet in person, you know, particularly for me, selfishly. It would have been great for me to meet you all and learning more about what you do in your committee, but we'll do that in due course. It has been it's been absolutely fine over the last few days in terms of having these electronic meetings. It's the warmth isn't there and the camaraderie isn't there. We can't go for a coffee or a beer or and chat around the corridors, but the positives are really that we've been able to engage much deeper with our stakeholders and allowing a much wider representation, which has been fantastic. You'd have seen from the voting that 127 nations voted for our presidential and vice president elections, which is 25% more than 2016. And I don't want to take any time. I just want to basically say it'd be lovely to meet you in due course. And thank you, Liz, and indeed all the committee members for giving up your free time for the well-being of our sport. And I wish you a productive session today and over the next few weeks.
Great. Thank you, David, and welcome in your new role. And I echo your comments that it would be great to meet in person, but it is the value of having our virtual meetings that everyone's learned so much about as we're going Absolutely. Along that they're working quite well. And then we can get all of us together at midnight or 4 o'clock in the morning and have productive meetings.
Yes.
Thank you. And stick around as long as you want.
I will do. Thank you very much indeed.
Great. And going back, I saw that, Marco Rolick wanted to make a comment on the, as we were discussing, the bid processes.
Yes, thank you, Liz. And just a question, because I know that you have personally done a lot of work with raising the awareness and also developing women match racing around the world. And you have one of the bullet points, which is the last in your report, is like recruiting additional people to fly the proud women's flag for match racing. And I just wanted to raise the question, are there any thoughts or any ideas on how to kind of make it even more attractive and better, so to say, and include more women in match racing?
Yeah, thank you for that, Michael. I was going to bring that up in my, we still have one more section on the agenda for the reports from the working groups. So although most of our work was on that, but let's bring that up again when we come back to that section, agenda item 14, because I think it can tie into the same discussion we'll be having on the youth match racing. But thank you for bringing it up, and thank you for actually reading my report. So I'll push that back, and let's go on to agenda item 9, which is the Blind Match Racing World Championships. And we're lucky to have as our moderator the Para World Sailing Manager. So Massimo, if you could give us just a little progress report on where we are with the Blind Match Racing World Championships.
Hi, everybody. We started end of 2019 to prepare the bid for the Blind Match Race World Championship. It took due to the furlough and this COVID situation, it took longer than expected. And now the bid is ready, has been approved by Liz. I sent the bid to the Blind Sailing International and the BJ to give the last opinion and approve it. I'm still waiting their answer. So as soon as I have news from them, we will post the bid. I don't know the situation because last year during the Blind Sailing International meeting in Kingston in Canada, there was a decision to skip 1 year, so to have a pause in 2020 and restart with the Blind Match Racing in 2021. I don't know if the decision of the Blind Sailing is to skip maybe even the 2021 because nothing has been done in 2020. So I need to understand from them what they want to do. But the bid is ready. So as soon as we know, and if they want to have an event in 2021, we are ready to release it.
That's great. Thank you, Massimo. I have had some discussions with the Blind Sailing International, BJ Blonick, who's the president of Blind Sailing International, as well as some others involved, Lucy Hodges in the UK and others. And BJ was asking for guidance on how other events were going forward in these times. And I gave him some examples of how other events are moving forward and the ideas that with the thought, if you don't move forward as if you're going to have the event won't happen. But if you move forward with the plan to have in the event and then put in some stop points where you can make the decision as to whether or not the event will happen. And I believe that's the guidance they'll be taking, but we'll see. I know that we have a couple of possible hosts for that event that I know there's at least one, and there's been discussion to move forward to get the bid material to them and see if we can work with them to host the event. So we'll see if what they come back. I'm hopeful that they would like to have an event, but understand the COVID situation may not allow that.
Yeah, perfect. So I'm waiting communication from them.
Great. Hopefully you will have it. I thought BJ had requested an invitation to this meeting, but I don't see him on the list of participants. But hopefully he will be able to reach out to him shortly. Okay. Any questions or comments on the Blind Match Racing World Championships? Related to that, I know that the Racing Rules Committee and a number of other groups, race management, have been working on amending or updating the Appendix CBS, so the Appendix C for the Blind Sailing, as well as the standard parasailing and paraworld sailing, including blind match racing notices of race and standard documents. So those have been going on in different working groups. So hopefully they will all be ready to go before too long.
Yes, the Appendix CBS is in the final review, and there is a working group, a working party with some of the member of the like race official, and also the let's say part of our training race management manual has been amended, and the final review has been submitted to the race management subcommittee. So as soon as we have a final decision, we are ready to post it online.
Great. Great, that sounds good. Okay, so if there are no other, I'm looking for raised hands. If there are no other raised hands on blind match racing, then we will move on to the next agenda item. Okay, I don't see any hands. So the next agenda item is item 10, the World Match Racing Tour. So we'll receive a report from the World Match Racing Tour Advisory Committee. Michael Rolick and Russell Green are the World Sailing representatives on that working party. We've received a report from World Match Racing Tour, James Pleasance, and I see we have James Pleasance, Craig Mitchell on the call as well. So let me first go to Michael Rolick, and then we'll go to James. So Michael.
Thank you, Liz. I must say that James and Craig, they have done a terrific job in very difficult circumstances here. And I know that they had a full scheduled plan for the 2020 year, and many of these actually competitions have been either rescheduled, postponed, or cancelled. And under the circumstances, I'm very glad to see that we will hold a single world championship also in this coming month. And I want to thank you for really having put an edge forward and having the match racing flag flying high. So what I would like to give the floor to James and Craig so that they could explain also a little bit about this year and also upcoming things and developing ideas.
Yeah, I think that's great. James, would you like to take it over and go over your report?
Yes, hi Liz. James here, can you hear me okay?
Yeah, you yes. Sound great.
I'm not sure how to turn my video on, but here you go. So welcome from a not quite locked down London yet, while our government decide whether we're allowed out or not, but for now we are. And good to join the meeting with a voice this year. As you, some of those of you who attended last year remember, I lost my voice during the meeting last year, which was a shame, but so I'm back in full health this year. Thank you, Michael, for your words. That's much appreciated. I should also add that the tour obviously is an umbrella brand for all of the events on the tour. So it's not just us bringing the tour together, but also the hard work of each of the independent and individual events that have been able to make their events happen this year. As my report that I sent says, some events unfortunately were forced to cancel, such as the Congressional Cup in Long Beach, California, because of the US travel restrictions, but some of the other events in slightly less restricted areas, such as Marstrand, the Match Cup Sweden event was able to go ahead this year, but on a local level, with a few Kiwis living in Sweden, such as Phil Robertson and Kyle Langford, who managed to get themselves on the invite list as honorary Swedes. Yes, in many ways, a shame this year. It's actually our 20th anniversary of the World Match Racing Tour this year, which is a shame, the challenging year we've had. And in January this year, you'll recall we announced an 18-event schedule, which I was very excited about. But obviously, that schedule has changed almost daily since March. And the upshot of it all is that the Bermuda Gold Cup, the 70th edition, actually, the Bermuda Gold Cup, which starts next Monday and runs Monday to Friday, 26th to 30th of October, is going ahead. And we are due to get on the plane this coming Friday Well, we were until last night when we received a hurricane warning, and Bermuda is expecting a hurricane at the very time that the plane lands on Friday. So we're waiting to see if we can actually get on to the plane. As if dealing with COVID restrictions wasn't enough this year, and they've already been hit by two hurricanes this year, so we've got it all on this year. But suffice to say, my congratulations to the Royal Bermuda Yacht Club, who were also able to increase their entry list to 16 teams, all of which have confirmed and are now attending the event next week. So we're excited about that. So it'll be a joint 70th Bermuda Gold Cup and a single event match racing world championship for this year. You may have seen the release, I think, a week ago with the list of entries. I won't go through them all. Suffice to say that we have the defending world champion, Phil Robertson, attending the event, and three other world champions, Taylor Canfield from the USA, Ian Williams, who will be competing for a record seventh world match racing title, and Torvar Mirsky from Australia, or from wherever he is coming from. As an additional point, and a release we just put out yesterday, it's the first time that we've also had female skippers compete in the Open Match Racing World Championship. So it's fantastic news. We have Pauline Courtois from France and Anna Osling from Sweden, who will be competing in the event next week. Pauline has raced the Bermuda event and the IODs, sailed the IODs before. It'll be Anna's first time at the event. So we're excited about that. And also a number of youth, local and youth teams as well. So a great spread of entries for the event next week. My congratulations to the Royal Bermuda Yacht Club for making that happen as well. The event will be run under a very robust safety precautions, sort of COVID safety restrictions, requiring every competitor to have a negative test prior to traveling, and then a test on arrival at the airport, and then a test on day 4, day 8, and day 14 in Bermuda. So Bermuda's been very robust with their testing, but they are determined that Bermuda is open for business. And also next week, the PGA Golf Championship will be taking place as well as a rugby event. So it's all on in Bermuda next week. So that's for this year. Unfortunately, the event will not be televised live next week, but we will have a small TV crew there to produce daily highlights and images, which you will be able to see. In terms of the 2021 schedule, what we're now working on is putting together the 21 schedule, which I would like to try and announce before the end of this year. Understandably, quite a few of the events haven't confirmed their dates for next year, as they're still working out some of their challenges from this year, but we would hope to have a tour announced by the end of this year. And as I put in my note there, we will be announcing a new final event on the tour next year, which was agreed during the lockdown period. That will be in December, and by the nature of the time of year, I won't divulge the venue just now, but it's of a more southern hemisphere venue for obvious reasons. So that'll be mid-December. We just need to confirm the dates, and that will be announced soon, which we're very excited about. The Congressional Cup hopes to be back in full speed in May next year, and we have announced that they will be part of the tour as well as the Bermuda Gold Cup and Match Cup Sweden in Marstrand. In terms of the tour card skippers, our plan is to continue the tour card skipper format for next year. And just to bring up the point that was brought up last year, the skippers are awarded on merit, not by any form of paid or bid process. We haven't confirmed the format for next year. Suffice to say that it is our thoughts at the moment that we would look to select the 6 tour card skippers from the results of this year's World Championship, or rather next week's World Championship, and others from the World Sailing ranking list, subject to an update from the ranking working party on when those rankings might be restarted, stroke reactivated again. And I've had some dialogue with yourself, Liz, and Jana, and Michael on when that might be. And then finally, with some other projects which we've been working on, hopefully to launch next year, we've been working on an academy idea, which for Michael O'Connor, I will share more with you on offline in terms of supporting what you're doing with the Nations Cup. Our plan being to use the tour and all of the match racing facilities, training and education facilities that are available around the world to try and promote more of the educational side for up and coming sailors to get into match racing, increase participation in match racing, and promote this pathway as to how they can get not only onto the World Sailing Rankings, but also into the World Match Racing Tour leaderboard. So we're excited about that. A lot of it's in concept phase at the moment because of the challenges we've had this year, but something we hope to be rolling out a bit more next year. And we're also working with a sustainability partner, which we're hoping to bring on board for next year, in line with our wishes to promote that with the tour. And also, to Michael Rolex's point, to promote more youth and female participation on the tour as well. And I think next week's World Championship, with Anna and Pauline competing in the Worlds, would be a great it's a great kickoff for that to perhaps lead the way in putting something together for next year, so that we can encourage more female skippers to not only sail on the tour, but also at the World Championship events. So in summary, yes, a challenging year. I thank every and all of each of the events on the tour for doing everything they can to run their events. And we look forward to working with them all next year and getting back on aeroplanes and rolling out what I hope will be a full tour for next year.
Great, thank you for that, James. And I would like to add, I did receive a note from Russell. So the World Match Race Tour Advisory Committee consists of James Pleasance, Craig Mitchell representing the tour, Eberhard Mag from Match Race Germany, and as I said before, Michael Rolick and Russell Green representing the Match Race subcommittee. And Russell was unable to be here, but he wanted to add the comments that he thought the advisory committee was operating very well this year, and lots of transparency and lots of good work, and that James has been great with his communication. And I would echo that as well. James has kept the Match Race Rankings group appraised of what's going on with their events. He's been keeping the Match Race subcommittee apprised of what's happening with all of the events, as well as obviously the office. And again, back to Russell's comments, that this is all certainly tracking in the right direction despite the difficult times, and deserves the Match Race subcommittee's full support. So I'd like to agree with Russell's comments and open up the floor to anyone else in the Match Race subcommittee first. If there are any questions or comments on this, or questions for James, or comments on the World Match Race Tour overall. Pedro, are there any raised hands that you see?
No raised hands.
Okay, so I'll open it up to any of the observers. Any questions or comments? You could either put a note in the chat or raise your hand, and Pedro or Massimo will
Liz, Michael here. Just very good news from Bermuda with the Open World Championship and the French team, Pauline Courtois, and being mixed. So I think this is an interesting development at a World Championship level, and we look forward to observing success of it.
Yeah, I agree. Getting women's match racing coming in line, and as we're seeing in a number of events, this, I believe, both Anna and Pauline's teams will be all female teams, but I believe Pauline competed last year with a mixed team there. So we're seeing more activity on women skippers with mixed teams coming to open events, but in this case, all women's teams coming alongside. And I know that the WIM series has been having some discussions with the World Match Race Tour about how to do some things together, perhaps, or at least have some events or people crossing over between the events. So I think some definitely some good movement, and along with all of the goals of increasing female participation in world sailing events. So good stuff. Thank you, James.
Somehow I see Alistair is trying to speak, I think. Alistair Fox?
Yeah, thanks, Pedro. Liz, if I could just make a couple of very quick points.
Yep, go right ahead.
It was mainly just to say to James, thanks for that report. Certainly all of the communications from James this year around the plans for the tour have been really good and really helpful. And I think we've got a good understanding of what they've been trying to achieve this year, and we're standing by to support them next year. And I think the point that you just made about what other activities can be driven around the World Match Racing Tour, I think that's a really interesting discussion for the future, whether that's the short term in 21, which may be a bit more challenging, but certainly long term. We've been having discussions from the office with James about the potential for the tour to do more in terms of promoting match racing. And I think it would be a really good topic for this committee to get stuck into and to work with James on as well. And it may be that some things are simple ideas that could be done, and it may be that other things would be a longer term plan. But I just think that the more that the tour can do to overall promote match racing would be a good thing.
Yeah, great. Thank you, Alistair, for that. And I think I echo what you say, that getting this, the Match Race Subcommittee working on that, and that could be both the, as we've seen, the youth match racing developments, women's match racing developments, and also in line with the Nations Cup. So getting more developing match racing countries, not developing nations per se, in line with that, as well as, you know, the involvement of the blind match racing in the para world sailing community. So I think there's a lot of opportunities for cross-pollination and working together. So great, thank you for that. Any other comments on the World Match Racing Tour? So the next topic, item 11, with the World Match Race, or sorry, Match Racing Gradings and Rankings. I'd like to actually have a fairly robust discussion on this. So to build up the anticipation for that, can we take a 5-minute break and then come back? We'll start with a report from Yana Dobutskaya and the Match Race Rankings Working Party, and then get into some in-depth discussion on what's happening and what are some ideas on how to make the rankings work in the COVID reality that we have. So can I propose that we take a quick 5-minute break and then be back in 5 minutes? So does that work for everyone? Does that work, Pedro?
Yes, absolutely. 5 minutes, perfect.
Okay, Liz. 5-minute break, and then we'll, yes?
Yeah, sorry, it's Jan. If you're going to take a 5-minute break, I might sign off here. But if I can just thank the match racing subcommittee for the work that they've done, in particular over the last 4 years. I know the last year has been particularly difficult with events and what have you, but I think that the work that everyone has done and the way that you've approached awarding of bids well in advance and sort of trying to develop match racing again has been really successful. So thank you for all the work you've done, and I'm sorry that we haven't been able to meet face to face.
Well, thank you for that, Jan, and I understand this is a bit tough in the middle of the night for a number of people.
It's one of a daily series, unfortunately.
Yeah. Okay. So thank you. Yep. So we'll take a quick pause. Thanks. And I just saw in the chat that Pauline Courtois will have a mixed crew. Thank you, Sylvain, for checking that for next week's event. So it'll be good having a mixed crew and all women's crew, and then obviously some open crews. Okay, so 5 minute break. So let's be back at, I'll make it a 7 minute break, but 20 minutes past whatever hour you were in, and we'll be back in a few minutes. Okay. I think people are coming back to their seats. There we go. There's Pedro. Okay. We're ready to continue. All good, Pedro? Pedro, you are muted still.
Right. So I'm just checking the new chats, and I see Young saying that the video and audio is not working, but he's attending the meeting.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Sungjul Jung says his video and audio aren't working, but he's attending the meeting. I encouraged him to write any comments in chat if he'd like to join in. So let's carry on where we were, which was the match race gradings and rankings. And for that, we'll turn it over to the chair of the Match Race Rankings Working Party, Yana Dobzhikskaya. So, Yana, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Liz. Good morning, afternoon, evening, everybody. Thank you for coming to us. I think we will have a live discussion now because I think we will need your help, all of you, to find a solution. So, let me start, please. our working party consists of Liz Baylis, Michael Rowley, and Sylvain Escura, and myself. And this year, of course, the main issue was the pandemic situation and how it is influenced to the world sailing ranking system. Because we all know that world sailing match racing ranking has like a 2 years rolling memory. And if we have something unstable, like we have last 6 months, it's influenced very badly. So we need to adjust the ranking system because of the reasons as I mentioned above. So what we were working on this with this our working party, and we proposed three solutions. Three options. First, and it's not really good one, it's a freeze ranking for a while and then revert back to the current mechanism at some future dates to be agreed once racing environment returns to normal. This is not really good option. We all agreed in this. So the next option number two, increase the year one window from 12 months to, for instance, to 8 months or 24 months or something in between, while still counting the best four results for year one and the best four results for year two, which is after the year one, consistently 12 months. And the third option is to duplicate the results of year two whenever the event cannot be held in year one due to COVID-19. Our point of view that the solution two is the best in what we have, and now we only need to know could it be implemented to the ranking system, which is using SOTIC, as I remember right, and if not, we have to think what to do with this. I will shortly continue with old report, and we come back to this issue later. Is it okay, please?
Let's actually continue. Sorry, discussing this part of the report, because I think it's really the meat of the issue, and then we can go back to finish your report after that, if that's all right.
So I continue, correct? Because I had echo from your side. Shall I continue?
Sorry. Are you still echoing, or is it okay?
Okay, I continue. So, also in last year period, we were answering some questions about possible downgrading, upgrading, and did any exceptions. And obviously it was not so many issues this year because it was very lack of events. So we were talking about Master International Youth Match Racing Regatta, Governor's Cup 19, Trophy Lionel van der Hoven European Match Racing Tour Stop 1 and Grade 2 in Skovhoved, Denmark. Some of them were about allowing umpires to umpire by one per boat, which was also mentioned in James Pleasant report. And some of them was just simple asking for due to restrictions caused by COVID-19. Also, we were discussing and we adjusted the event application grading form. And this is from 2020, this is new form now, which all changes are related to youth teams participations, and this form now can be used for the youth ranking when it starts. And last year we agreed that we are working on the youth ranking, even if we cannot start right now, we will collect the reports about youth participations in match racing, and then when we start with the ranking, we can use last 2 years' reports. Also, we were working with World Sailing staff, with Pedro. Thank you very much, Pedro, to establish World Sailing ranking release schedule and adjust it for better service for match race teams. Again, it was not really work this year, but anyway, it's our usual job, so we are doing it. And we were discussing wording for weight limits for grading criteria, and we can also talk about it more if you want. But actually, it will need the changing of the grading criteria, which means changing of the regulations, and I think it's our further plan to work. The plan for next year for the match race ranking working party, if it will be established by the new board, is to work on match race ranking system, to adjust it to the pandemic influence, also to work with World Sailing staff on the implementing of youth divisions to match racing rankings, which is now stopped. This work was stopped because of all this pandemic issue. We still have to work on the submission, which allows us to leave the grading and rankings out of the regulations, so to change regulation 27.2, and to review the grading criteria and World Sailing standard guidelines for organization grade WC 1 and 2 match race events. That's all from my side, and I'm ready to discuss more the pandemic influence to the ranking and what we can do for finding the solution for this. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Jana. Sorry, I'm not sure.
Liz, can you use your earphones because we all hear echo?
Yeah, I am using my headphones. So it's kind of strange. I'm not sure who I'm echoing through. Ah.
Oh, no, so. It's better.
Okay, I think.
Now it seems fine, Lisa. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. So I lost my train of thought with that echo, sorry. Let's go back and discuss the different options for how we can solve this ranking issue in this pandemic time. Jana, I'll take it back to you. Yep.
Excuse me. May I would like to thank very much Sylvain Escura. He did absolutely outstanding job to find some solutions and to work how it could influence the ranking. And he was talking to participants, to sailors, to match racers, which was really, really good. Thank you, Sylvain. I know that you hear me. And thanks to all working party for your hard job this year, because despite of lack of events, we had a lot of discussion about this issue and we have to continue this. Thank you. So Maybe Sylvain, can you tell us something about? Can you add something about our solution too?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Well, we try to see what could be options, like these three options, and it was all about finding the right mix between being extremely conservative on one side, and by freezing the system for a long time, and on the opposite, by trying to promote sailing and match racers who actively sails and who need to be rewarded for sailing. So basically, solution two is a bit of a mix like that. Like if you score points, if you scored points in the last 2 years before the pandemics, you keep your points, whatever happens, which we believe is a good thing. And if you did sail during the pandemic, if you were lucky enough to have the opportunity to sail, you can add new points to your ranking, which we believe is fair and can attract like new sailors or anyone who can sail. That's the idea of solution two, basically. So I'm not going to go into more details, but for us, it was the best compromise that we found, knowing that we still have to agree on how long this period would last. If it's like 18 months, 24 months, do we need to agree in advance because we want to have something defined for the tour cards, or is that, do we need to wait for the end of the pandemic if such thing exists? So it's quite open for debate, but basically we believed, as Yana said, that solution two could be a good option.
Yeah, thank you for that, Sylvain. And I think another point that we need to bring up is that this is also, we're trying to encourage the events to happen. So even if they are running as local events, trying to encourage the events to happen and encourage the sailors to sail. So it has to, both things have to be balanced together. So Pedro would like to speak on this from the office and the management side of things.
Thank you very much. I just want to say that it's been very difficult here to be on top of all the match racing events due to the furlough and lack of time to do that. I believe that from now on I will be able to get better and better. So please, to the all organizers of match racing events, if you feel that we are missing something urgent, just send a message directly to me again. And also to thank Sylvain, big thanks of his personal help to me on at least the events that he have control and can just update when I couldn't. One thing that we are still waiting for at least 1 month now, it's the answer from SOTIC about the possibility to make these changes. As you know, we are changing our website, and this is part of the a big project. And what we need is urgent, and it means that it's another project to change the old version of our of our website. We still don't have the answer, and so I will leave with one question, or maybe two questions actually. One is how fast we want to implement this after it's decided, and if it's too fast for SOTIC or not possible for SOTIC at all, if what options do we have to do this? Thank you.
Well, thank you, Pedro. I think for the point of view of how quickly to implement this, or how can we implement it if SOTIC can't come up with a solution, I think we've seen Sylvain and what he's done with the rankings in France, and has actually applied this sort of system to data the French events and the French sailors and working with them in somewhat real time. It's a smaller subset, obviously. It's not the whole world ranking list. It is all the French sailors, but able to implement it and actually able to show that it is working within that system, and it looks like a fair solution for the sailors who can keep sailing. So I think that Pedro's question is, when can we implement this? I think if we could get an answer from SOTIC that comes back and says, yeah, no problem, we can implement it in our current system, I think we should do an analysis of what it looks like and how it affects it. And then after that, if we get back from SOTIC and they say they can't do anything, then do we look at the possibility of taking the data from the SOTIC system, from the database, and analyze it manually and see if we could generate a static manual list for some period of time, if that makes sense. So we could say November 2020, we take the data as it stands, do our own analysis of it separately, and then publish a PDF version of the ranking list for a static time point, and then maybe do that every 2 months until we can have a fluid system again. So that might be an option. Okay, Jana, you wanted to say something?
Yes, I was just was going to say the same. So if SOTIC cannot do it, probably our working party discussing and probably find a solution how to do it manually. With the, of course, we need the data and Pedro with us. So, but I think we have to have the new rating this year at least once more. Not only 8th of April, but we have to have something in November. It's better because and Walmart Tour is waiting for this also.
Yeah, what Jana is saying, that the World Match Race Tour has asked us, has asked the working party for a ranking because they would like to use that, as James presented in his paper, for making their tour card invitations for the 2021 season. So maybe we can look into, if we don't hear back from SOTIC or if we hear back that SOTIC can't do this, is it possible to do a end of year ranking or near the end of the year ranking that we can have as a static ranking to at least bring us up to date using this method too that we've discussed. So maybe I'll ask Sylvain, since he's the one, and then I see Michael's hand is up, but Sylvain, since you actually are the one experienced with whether or not this might work, you've done it in France. Do you think that a manual manipulation of it would work with a larger database?
Well, I don't have any doubt about it. We do keep in mind as a working party that it's not an ideal solution. It has to be something temporary and it has to be fully transparent as well. But clearly on my side, the code I wrote to build the ranking based on the data works. So I just have to include all the events worldwide to run it. And then I can publish in PDF and publish more details about how it's calculated to ensure it's fully transparent for the months it would be used.
Great, that sounds, I had a feeling that you had a solution that would work. Okay, and so Michael O'Connor would like to make a comment.
Just a couple of words. The three solutions, the second obviously has got the most flexibility, which is the most important in this case, rather than be stuck with a set of rules that don't work or penalize a group of sailors that can't sail because their governments don't allow it at a certain point in time. But I think what Sylvain is suggesting could be could be a way of doing it with a simple Excel file behind it, and just taking, and with the rules being established of how it's going to be done, so it is transparent and published, and then the input data is particular sailors at particular time, and then taking that forward for any number of months, and it could be the whole of 2021 in reality, given what the slowness of going back into full bore match racing with its 300 or so graded events a year. So we could be done on a selective basis, and that could be very interesting, and it's dynamic, which is maybe in some cases better than an IT system written by somebody externally, which would have errors initially anyway. So I think that would be a very good route.
Great. From an implementation or from a regulation standpoint, obviously this is going away from what is written in the regulations on how the calculations are done. This, I believe, would need to be, Pedro, maybe help me if I'm wrong on this, it has to be a proposal to the board for approval if we were, yes, to implement it.
Should come a proposal from this subcommittee to the events committee, which we then the events committee can propose directly to the board or to the council. It depends what we are dealing at the end. But I think it's the board can deal with this directly from the events committee.
Okay, so from the events committee that. That doesn't have to be in this time frame of this current annual conference?
No.
Or no, okay. Great.
No,
good.
If it's like this, just we should make a recommendation not based on any submissions, with what we need, and propose as urgent to the events committee and have their approval to send for the board to approve it as urgent. If it's outside this conference, we just need to present to the board a new solution because it's needed, it's urgent.
Okay, I see Alistair would like to speak. Thank you, Alistair.
Yeah, thanks, Liz. Sorry for interrupting again, but I just thought it might maybe reassure is maybe the best word, you, that this isn't a rankings issue specifically for match racing. We've got as many challenges with the Olympic rankings, and we had a long discussion last night with the Olympic classes about the way forward. And Liz, as you mentioned, with furlough and the budget situation and website projects constantly being delayed really over the last 3 years, it's been pretty challenging, and we know how important the rankings are, obviously for you, but equally for the Olympic classes as well. So I would absolutely encourage you to make a recommendation through the events committee. I'm absolutely sure the events committee will do something very similar for the Olympic rankings. And then outside of any kind of conference recommendations, I mean, please just take it as read that Pedro, Matt, who looks after the Olympic rankings, myself, Daniel, we are all extremely aware of how important this is. So once the elections are over and a new board is in place, this will be one of the highest priority projects we're tackling.
Great. So could I take that maybe we should say that in our yellow paper that our recommendations outside of submissions that we need to come up with a solution to fix the rankings, and then outside of the meeting we will come up with a recommendation through the events committee.
Yeah, I would strongly recommend you do that.
Okay, great. Any other comments on the workability of that solution too, and or another idea? I know that the World Match Race Tour had some comments earlier in the year about how this might work. Do we, James or Craig, have anything they would like to say on this? Do I have silence or do I have a hand that I can't see? Okay, anyone else, any of the observers care to make any comments on this or thoughts?
Craig said option two would be the best in the chat.
Okay, great. Any twists on it or changes, or do you think?
Michael here on the just the, if it's done manually effectively, then whatever spreadsheet is used or whatever, there should be a MATRACE subcommittee sign off on it before it's released, and that happens already with the subcommittee that exists for rankings. But I think that sign off is probably more particular to have it cross checked, because if it's manually wrong, then it can have quite serious impact on major events. So I think just caution on that, maybe a governance procedure within the MATRACE subcommittee is how to sign off and release, especially if there's one person involved doing it manually. It's very easy for things to creep in, rather than an IT system, which is cross-check proven, and then that produces the results.
Yep, I agree. So I think the thought will be it'll come out of the sorry, I'm looking at the chat. Yep. what we'll do an analysis out of the rankings working party, and then bring that proposal of how the analysis is done, and our recommendations to the events committee. We'll have the subcommittee approve that, and maybe we'll at that point have an example of what it looks like, what the data looks like, and then go forward to the events committee and the board. Great, yeah. How long, the question is, how long are these extension going to be for year one? Excuse me. And we've already seen that it's eight, we're 8 months into this, and we don't really see normal happening probably within the year, which is going to make year one a full 2 years. So extending to 21 months or 24 months does seem like a sensible thing to allow more events to stay in that have happened. And so people don't lose their rankings just because they can't travel, and don't lose event status because the events haven't happened. Craig is asking some things in chat. Consider how to stream back to previous timings. So I think that is asking how, at the end of the COVID time, how do we roll it back to get back to a simple 12-month and 12-month for year one and year two, and to try and make that transition smooth if possible. And the recommendation that we implement it for 12 months. So we have the extended period go for 12 months and then roll back into the 12-month time. So if we start looking at this and looking at a December 1st or even January 1st, January 1st, it might make it easier and cleaner, and being able to say, okay, this is the system that will be in place for 2021. We'll have a ranking at the end of 2020, and then that takes into account the extended format, so the COVID system, and then say January 1st, say it will be from here until January 1st, 2022. They'll make it last for a year. Does that seem to make sense? Does that make sense to you, Sylvain?
I believe it's already quite important if we all agree on solution two. That said, I fully agree that there are some details that we need to work on. So I don't know if it's the right place to keep discussing that or if it's more at working party level. Clearly, I fully agree that we have to take into account, for instance, the starting date of the pandemic. Was it March? Was it April? From when do we publish this? What is the total pandemic period we have to agree on? It's a lot of details. And again, I don't know if it's the right place to discuss that. Open question.
Yeah, no, I like having just the opportunity for other people to chime in. We've been, the four of us have been pretty focused on what we think will work. So it's good to hear some other suggestions. And we may want to bring additional help in, like Craig Mitchell is giving us some ideas here, and keep him in the discussion going forward with the working party. So I think at this point, I'd like to get from the MATRE subcommittee, basically ask for approval to move forward with solution two, and just for the working party to start ironing out the details of how solution two might work. I would say we should go forward with the belief that we're not going to get a solution from SOTIC in the near future, and that we may want to come up with a manual solution to work with. So can I get agreement from the MATRE subcommittee members to move forward with the working party working on solution two, and that we make recommendations to the events committee that this is an urgent need that we'll need to go to the board with a solution? So I think maybe the best way to do this would be in the chat. If the committee members would just say if they agree with moving forward, or if they would like to have further discussion at the subcommittee level. So waiting to hear from Yana and Sung Shul. Okay, great. So we have a unanimous agreement that we will move forward at looking into the details of a solution two solution, and we will make the recommendation to the events committee that this is an urgent need and we need to come up with a solution. And thank you for the discussion on this, and thank you. And I hope that those of you have added some suggestions, such as Craig, that we might be able to tap you on the shoulder and get a little help from you in the next month or so. Great. Going back to the rest of Yana's report, was there anything else on the other events and the other parts of what the working party has been on the working party report? I believe it's been very difficult with getting the events reports and into the system with the furloughs, as Pedro mentioned. And at the beginning of the year, and the beginning of the before the furlough, Sylvain was also helpful in getting some of the events cleaned up and the data cleaned up in the ranking system. So hopefully going forward, Pedro might be able to get some help again from Sylvain and others to get the events listed. We cleaned up the calendar as things were getting shut down for COVID. So we will need to start getting the calendar back up and running and encouraging the events to put events on the calendar. And then obviously with the caveat that there may be cancellations depending on what government regulations are happening. And hopefully we won't have just natural disasters in addition to the pandemic. So hopefully the hurricane won't have too much influence on the World Championships next week. So I'm going to skip around a little right now because I know that we have Tatiana Emrakova, I think I will pronounce it correctly, from the
Hi.
Race Management Subcommittee is here with us, and I know it's late at night for her. So I would like to skip to agenda item 14A4. And have a report from the Race Management and Organizations Working Party, which Tatiana is leading. So we have a report, here it is. So Tatiana, I'll turn it over to you and welcome.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Can you hear me well? Yeah, okay. I'm missing a real conference. This is the first thing I want to say, because I've been just 5 hours at the Race Management Committee closed meeting. And even more, I realize how I need a normal conference. So, okay, now to the report. So we made it. We finished the manual about how to organize match racing event of different levels. We did not touch, of course, some very high level event like World Match Tour or America's Cup, but it's normal from grade 5 to grade 1. You can find information there how to make it, how to organize, where to look at, and how to run it on the water. So it consists of 6 sections. Each section is devoted to this or that matter, like what kind of people you need, how many people. So not to forget anything, including a shore team, media team, people who work on the water, everything. Then it's about formats, how to choose which format to use, how to decide about grading, of course. So everything about equipment, about what else do we need from the equipment point of view, if we compare with the fleet racing, what is the difference? And the largest part is about running races on the water. It also has some useful forms, race management forms. So we really hope that this is helpful. It's not perfect in any way, and of course, later work on it will be welcome if somebody finds something else to be added. We think that this manual will help race officers to be more consistent, and the sailors can expect similar level of the service, similar procedures, similar performance. We really hope it will help. I want to thank the Race Management Subcommittee, because we used a good deal of race management manual, especially the part of match racing, because it existed before. We just looked where to put what, where relevant, where it was about, for example, personnel, we used that part. When about how to choose racing area, we used that part. What flags do we use on the starting vessel? We use that part. So we distributed it along the whole document with a logical order. I want to thank everybody. I want to thank my team for working with us. Also, we had some exchange of information with the US Match Racing Committee or Match Racing Specialists. So we use some ideas also from their documents. What else I want to say about this manual is that it contains some links to different documents, like regulations which are living, which are changing, some online resources. So it's good if we keep an eye to look that they're still up to date, all these links. And I wonder, will it be published, or this is a question now, or will it be distributed to a potential organizers or former organizers or those who want just to rise to the level of the grade of the event? So how is it going to be used? That is my question.
That's great, Tatiana, because that was my question to you, or maybe it's my question okay. to Pedro. It's where would this manual be published? I assume it would be, there should be a place on the website, on the World Sailing website, for where the other documents such as the notices list. So I'm getting a nod from Pedro. So
yes.
I think in the document library for umpires, race officials, and things like that.
Yes, so there is one thing to do first is to receive the manual as it is, and we will need to prepare it and brand it as an official document. And then we will publish in the website linked from the organizing events, race officers and well, race officials in general and match racing, where, for example, the guidelines are now published. It will be in the same area.
Great. So I think yeah, the marching orders would be then Tatiana send it to Pedro, and Pedro can get it to the marketing people to get the branding put on and get it put in the correct format.
Yes.
But I also agree that it is a living document, and it should be, whether your working party continues or whether this should be something that either the race management subcommittee or the match race subcommittee needs to take ownership, or at least shared ownership, in to make sure it stays up to date in the future. So yeah, great work for your group working on this. I know you've been at it for a while, and the finished product is very nice. I didn't look at it in detail, but I looked it over it enough to think that it's going to be a good resource for people starting match racing events, but also a good resource for people who are already running events. But definitely a great way to get new people up and running. So for example, the Nations Cup group, when we start reaching out to new venues and getting match racing going in different places, that would be definitely a first tool to use to help get new organizations going. So great, thank you very much to your group. And thank you, Tatiana, for being here in the middle of the night and after your other meeting. So, anyone have any questions for Tatiana or any comments? Otherwise, we'll let her go and go to sleep.
Okay, thank you.
Michael Rolick raised his hand. So Michael, before Tatiana goes away, Michael, if you have something, you can speak. If someone will unmute you. Michael Rolick.
And before you go to bed, Tanya, I must say that I want to thank you for doing a terrific and a humongous job in pulling our working party together. And I think that when we're building a new event, when we are building stronger and better events, both for sailors and organizers, I think this manual will be of great help. So I just wanted to say this, and then you have a solid and nice sleep.
Okay, thank you. Michael, special thanks to you. You know why, okay? You know why. Okay, thank you. Okay, Pedro, I will send it right away.
I'm Tatiana. It's Michael here from Ireland. Yes. This is a really good document. We've all got these bits and pieces everywhere, what we think is best practice, and having it all together with pairing lists and everything else is very, very valuable for up and coming. So well done, and thank you for being the organizer for the Nations Cup in Russia in 2015 in Vladivostok.
It was a pleasure. Thank you very much. I miss everybody, really. Okay, bye.
Sleep well.
Great. Thank you, Tatiana.
Thank you.
Okay, so now we'll move back on the agenda. We received a report, agenda item 12, race officials. We did receive a report from Sally Burnett, the chair of the IU subcommittee. And here it is. Obviously, with not too many events going on, but they've done some work to make sure people don't lose their, the IUs and other race officials don't lose their certification because of no events being, or not very many events being held. and then also the, with seminars being canceled and so forth. There has been something at, obviously, James mentioned it earlier, but we've seen it at other events, that with social distancing and also the inability or the difficulty in travel, that some events have been using the one umpire format instead of two. That, and Sally wants to stress that it's, this is not a precedent, but that exceptional circumstances and obviously a world championship level, for example, having strong umpire team and good decision making is very important, but adjusting to situations and adaptability is also important so that we can keep the sport going. and as she says, hopefully at the end of the quad and new subcommittees forming, that keeping a good working environment between the IU subcommittee and the MATRACE subcommittee is very important, and working together with all the other stakeholders, and especially being adaptable with these different ideas is important for all of us. So any comments or thoughts from the subcommittee on the IU subcommittee report? Okay. Let's carry on. So submissions. This is one of those unique years that we have no submissions that we have put forward. And I believe there was maybe only one submission that from the racing rules, from a call that was related to match racing. But anyone have any discussion? Usually when it's racing rules, I would ask Russell Green to lead that discussion, but he's not with us this evening or today. Does anyone have any comments on any submissions from the subcommittee? Any comments from the observers on that? Okay. I'll take that as no, but I think we can move on from item 13 to get into item 14. We've already had the race management and organization presentation. Again, I have no report from Russell on the match racing rules, and I don't think we have anyone on the call from the racing rules committee. So we won't have a report from that. So we go back to, I'm going to switch this up because I'm going to let the youth match racing. So let's start with 14A3, youth match racing. And that's a group led by Michael Rulick. We've already heard part of this, but Michael, why don't you take the floor? Sorry. Michael Rolick, your microphone.
Yes, thank you very much. Okay. All right, so initially when we started our working party, what we did is we gathered ideas to create a five-year plan with a one-year implementation. And what we have done is we have followed these steps that we outlined in this plan. Obviously, some of the steps have been taken faster forward and other ones have not proceeded in that time. But the overall picture is that Actually, we have made quite good progress, and I want to start by thanking Jana Dobšinskaya and Dave Perry, who have been very, very supportive. And we also extended the working party in year two with Ai Li Ning from Singapore, Annika Ekman from Sweden, Sung Shun Leong from South Korea, Laurie Jury from New Zealand, Ricardo Lobato Blue from Brazil, and Lucy de Freitas from South Africa. So all these people have contributed to what we are doing and what we are achieving. The first two points, actually, you already heard and made comments on that. So what I wanted to continue actually is what we have discussed about the big documents and event contracts. And there we have made some recommendations for word sailing based on the feedback that we have got from event organizers and sailors. And the first recommendation was to try to fit the youth match racing worlds into 1 week. And therefore, we have made a recommendation on the schedule of the event. And that has been really good followed, actually, by the event organizers, so that many of these people, they are in school. And from that perspective, they can concentrate on traveling during 1 week and racing during 1 week. The other one thing that is very important that has been addressed actually several times during this discussion already is that it's very, very important actually when you're dealing with youth, when you're dealing with the Nations Cup, to input a clinic at the beginning of the event, since not many of the teams arrive with a coach. And therefore, what we have done is to encourage the event organizers, and this was done the first thing in Ekaterinburg in Russia last year, and in Auckland, New Zealand this year, that there was a clinic, there was coaching on the water, there were debriefings, and this is very good to share knowledge and also to work on your skills as a crew and from that perspective grow match racing and interesting in match racing. Another thing that has several times actually occurred, and here I want to thank Word Sailing and the Word Sailing commercial team for accommodating and taking an updated position of the commercial rights. So they consider blind match racing, women's match racing, youth match racing, and Nations Cup to be smaller events. And then what they can do is they can be a little bit more liberate on sponsorship agreements. And this has helped the events, which are not big, don't get that much money from the fees that they require sponsors to throw a good event. And here I want to really emphasize that we super much appreciate the World Sailing commercial team for taking this standpoint. Another thing that was done during this year, we made a survey, and we have around a little less than 100 names, which are youth match racing liaisons throughout the world. And that's people who are dealing with match racing or interested in youth match racing and supporting youth match racing. What we wanted to do is to still kind of raise the awareness of youth match racing, add to the list of names so that we have everybody included, and also learn about youth match racing programs. One very interesting thing is that the age band is quite high in youth match racing. It goes from 14 to 27 years. And we got to remember that the answer is from 11 youth match racing liaisons. However, we also know that world sailing age limit for youth match racing is under 23. So this is something that perhaps we need to learn what's the background, and perhaps somebody on this call already knows if there is a certain reason for keeping it under 23. But that's something that I think that we could talk about. Obviously, recruiting it is done in many ways. Schools, from Dignity Sailors, from classes, and many of the youth events and the local or national youth match racing events are actually placed later in the season, that you can attract different sailors from the classes and the Dignity Sailors. And perhaps one thing that we have been working on also is a youth match racing Facebook page. What we did is now it's discoverable. It's easy to find it. And I gotta still work on the technicality because I noticed that I can invite only people which are friends. So perhaps somebody more literate in Facebook or Facebook group can help me with that one. And what we're trying to do is also to spread the word through this, share resources, update about youth events and so on. So next steps very shortly. We're looking into creating a youth matricing kind of Instagram account, and that's just to reach out again, very simple and similar format, and create links. The other thing is to share the survey results with all the liaisons and perhaps get a little bit more feedback and opening up of the different programs. And obviously what we're going to do is to dig into the five-year plan again, update it so that we have another view of a longer view, so to say, what are the most crucial issues. And also obviously try to establish how well have we performed on the different tasks that we have set for ourselves. So this is just in short, and I'm happy to answer any questions or any good ideas on how to proceed.
This is great. Thank you, Michael, and thank you to all of your working party, and great to see the expansion of the working party to have so much more global reach, and obviously more people involved and some great activity. For your thoughts on the Instagram account and the Facebook page, we need to maybe be looking at some of the younger people on your working party might be the ones who can help us with that.
Yes, totally agree.
Michael O'Connor would like to say something.
Yeah, well done, Michael. And what you have
it's
here.
It's a team effort.
Yeah, with the younger audience is actually a platform to drive the communication back home. And if you recall what we did in the 2018 World Championship Youth was Facebook Live, which was the virtual press conference from the venue back home to M&As, to sponsors, to families. And it really worked successfully. So, and the younger guys, the younger folks organized that. And it's their social media network that goes out. It goes out to, and it's very, very powerful. So it's a way of bringing social media to youth match racing globally.
Yep, that was a really good thing.
Yeah, I think continuing with this, with your actions moving forward and growing this, it's the same, what you've said, for growing youth match racing is how do we get more younger women involved as well. So that does dovetail into the women's side of things. I believe it is agreed upon for next year's Youth Match Racing World Championships that the teams will have to be mixed gender. Is that?
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah, so I think that growing youth in that way and growing women sailing in that way, bringing it up from the younger groups, I think currently, I believe the U.S. has required their youth match racing national championships has a mixed gender. So this is also carrying forward, which will increase activity. And hopefully then if we see that at the youth match racing world championship level, then we start to see more activity at the world match racing level that's showing the mixed gender events, and obviously seeing what's happening with the Olympic offshore events, although that's not match racing, it's having again mixed events that are not just youth but older people as well. So this is great. Any other questions from the observer group I think we have a couple of your members of the of your working party are in the observers. Any comments from the observers? I don't see any hands there. Okay, great, and thank you again to that working party for all the work they've done, and looking forward to seeing some continued activity on the youth level going forward. Great to have a focused plan moving forward and getting more outreach. And I do echo that getting the sailors involved in the social media is definitely a good way forward to get some more activity and a further reach than what we can do just at a, you know, at the top level of an event, social media, but getting the kids involved, so to speak, and letting them work and share and getting them active. The example Michael O'Connor did expressed with the Facebook Live press conferences, and even just getting interviews on the water that can go out on Facebook Live on an informal basis are great, and getting more engagement before events, after events, and throughout the year. So great team effort. Good job. Okay, so now we can get to the agenda item that I've been waiting for. No, the women's match racing. And I think it really does carry on that youth, getting the youth match racing advancing will help increase women's match racing. We see that all across our sport is if we see that girls involved at the youth level and how do we carry them into the upper levels of match racing. We've got at the upper level of women's match racing, the WIM series, which of course due to COVID this year was canceled, but we could see increased activity and new teams were joining, and the end of 2019, looking forward to 2020. So hopefully we'll be able to get them engaged for 2021. WIM series will is currently looking to continue for 2021 with a similar, there were, I believe, six events planned for 2020. So I believe that would be where it will go for 2021. Again, barring the lockdowns of COVID, so we'll have to see. It's a dynamic schedule, just as it has is with the World Match Race Tour. The question is, how do we get more sailors involved, more women involved? I think going forward, looking at building a working party such as has been for the youth match racing is a way to do that. But you know, I've been carrying that flag for a number of years now. And so it'd be good to see how we can grow this into a working party of more than one. And so we will need someone to carry that flag going forward aside from me. I'm happy to share my wisdom, but we need someone else to start carrying that flag. And so any ideas that come from this group would be great, or maybe some recommendations to the new, you know, for our last couple of weeks, our last couple of months, I guess, of this current subcommittee, and then moving forward into the next appointment of the subcommittee. It would be great to get some recommendations of women who could champion, or men who would like to champion women's match racing in different regions and take it on as the global level and to work together. I think one of the things we've seen at the youth level and the women's level, that getting local spark plugs, getting someone to carry the torch locally, and then let that spread. And whether locally is a region of a country or locally is a single country, and then tying together those different local groups to work together at a global level. So, yep. So the comment from James in the chat that Anna Usling in Sweden has been very proactive in promoting women's match racing. Definitely agree with that. And we've worked with Anna, and I've tried to get her to take the flag and run with it a couple of times, but with a young family, she backs off of that, but I will maybe try to promote that again. But any additional names that come from people, or maybe James, when you see her next week, while you're sitting out the hurricane in Bermuda, you could bring this up with her and see if she would be willing to champion that activity. Any other comments from others?
Perhaps one comment.
Yep, Michael.
If we look about the, how match racing is evolving, we have mixed teams in the World Match Racing Tour. We're going for mixed teams in the Youth Match Racing Worlds. We have women's and mixed in Nations Cup, and I know that it's already a second or two times they will run the Midsummer Match Cup in Sweden, which is also mixed teams. So I think that is one way to kind of get more people involved and learn from each other, and also that will definitely, when you share the wisdom and the skills and the ways of working, then you can really develop the game.
Yeah, I like that idea of the mixed events, and they have been shown to be very successful, and having mixed teams at the open events as well. So a forced mixed event such as the Midsummer, which required two from each gender to compete together, is a great way to do that. And related to that is having the youth requirement, as we see in something like the Volvo Ocean Race, where you're required to have one youth or some number of youth members and some number of women's competitors. So maybe that's where we also have the passing down of knowledge from senior sailors to youth sailors as well. So definitely some good suggestions. Any other thoughts on women's match racing? Any of the observers have anything they'd like to add? If there's any hands raised. Nope, no hands. Okay. Yeah, I think if anyone has any suggestions, please share them with me or with other members of the subcommittee to see if we can grow our presence, women's match racing presence outside of it. Obviously, I've been working quite a bit with Anna Holmdahl White in Sweden as well, and Katie Spithill Pelu in Australia with some suggestions. We have seen this year some national women's national championships have happened. I believe in my report I said it was, we saw it in Finland, the United Kingdom, New Zealand, and then France will be holding one in the next couple of weeks. So there has been some women's match racing activities at the national level, which has been great to keep things moving. So hopefully we'll continue to see more activity going forward. Great. Okay, so I think that takes care of all of our working group reports. And so 14B is to make any recommendations to council. Do we have any recommendations we would like to make to council from this meeting? I think the only one that we would like to make would be making recommendations to the events committee regarding the rankings. So maybe Yana, Pedro, and I can go offline later with how to write that up and what that recommendation would be. I think we have the consensus that we, from the subcommittee, that we want to make a recommendation on solution B for the rankings, and so we'll go forward with that recommendation. Any other comments or other recommendations to council? Okay, I don't see anything in the chat. Oh, sorry. Was that Michael O'Connor?
Maybe just a couple of two paragraphs on the growth of match racing and where it stands at this point in time. Often it's forgotten about as a specialist sport, but it's kind of a specialist discipline, but it's actually integrating into sailing, mainstream sailing in a big way, because most sailors do a bit of match racing and do some other types of sailing at the same time or flip-flop backwards and forwards. And so what is happening now in the development of major events, the tour, and also other events, youth, women's, it could be interesting to just say it's growing. People don't regard that in the, if they're dealing in pure Olympic classes, they don't understand the popularity. And the emerging part, especially with the youth being 14 to 30. So making that statement, I think, rather than the recommendation.
Okay. I don't know where we stand in the formalities of making a statement versus making a recommendation. Pedro, perhaps you could help me. Or Alistair, if you're still on. We've lost Alistair.
I believe the statement can be passed to the council by someone when the chairs of the events committee have the word. I think you can ask for us, yeah, the opinion of your subcommittee regarding the this development.
Okay.
As a statement.
Great. Okay. I will put that into our, I will have a report for the events committee, and whether I present that or Michael Rolick presents it, or it's just a written report to the events committee. So great. Thank you for that.
Yeah.
Great. Now we're on to the last agenda item. Any other business? Does anyone have any other business they would like to bring up before we close the meeting? We still have 25 minutes that we don't have to use, but we may use. So. Any?
Liz, I think it's the end of your four-year term. And I think we need to thank you most sincerely for being our leader during this period, and bringing everybody together and actually growing this sport that we value so highly. And so you have 20 odd people on this call, but they're all deeply involved in running different parts of this. And you've actually been able to coordinate this at the same time as doing a stellar job on developing women's match racing with both patience and grace. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael, for that. You stole my thunder a little. I was going to say a thank you at the end. But
I was just worried in case you'd run away.
Yeah.
I'd run away and just hide. Yeah. Some people do that. Wanted to catch you first.
Yeah, I am looking forward to running away and hiding a little. But yeah, thank you. And thank you to, let's see, everyone. Thank you to everyone who's been on this subcommittee for this last 4 years. But I might actually correct Michael and say this is the end of my 12th year in World Sailing, I believe, my third quad. Two as well, one as a committee member with Henry Menon as our leader. Then I took over the Match Race Committee, and then the Match Race Subcommittee as chair. And I would also like to thank all of the subcommittee members, the committee members who were with me before, the subcommittee members for this last four. And it's been a great honor to work with all of you and to see the enthusiasm, not just from the subcommittee members, but from the staff particularly, and then also the group of observers. Many of you who are in the observer crowd right now have been very active in match racing and continue to be very active in match racing. We have a great pool that we can draw on outside of the official committee members, and it's been great to work with everyone because everyone has the same passion for the sport and how to grow it. And as Michael O'Connor said, that match racing, although is a special discipline, there's match racing in all of the sailing we do and all of the racing we do. So keeping match racing, the match racing culture alive, is a very important part of getting new people involved, and especially when the youth events where we have boats provided. So the clubs that own boats and then are able to bring in people who aren't buying their own boats, but keeping them active and sailing. So going forward, I'll still be involved. It's sort of hard to get away from it all, but I look forward to seeing a new crop of committee members for the match race subcommittee. But before we're done with that, I believe our term, and Alistair or Pedro can correct me on this, our term goes through the end of the year. So there is some carryover to work with the incoming board and also many of you. Sorry,
I think I have someone. Right. I think it's till February.
Till February. Oh, yeah. Okay. There we go. End of February.
He looks very happy.
Well, better. I haven't told my husband that yet. Yes, and we'll continue on. Okay, so through the end of February. So we still have four more months of work to do before we turn this over. So some of the activities we've all talked about. Going forward, there will be some good carryover to continue those activities. So don't stop just because the meeting's ending. We will see how much we can get implemented before we turn it over. And I know a number of you will be continuing on in the next quad, which is great. So let's keep working and keep working together, keep getting the support from our communities. I think we all have marching orders of some things we need to keep working on. And again, thank you very much to the staff for their support, and thank you to all the committee members. So I think we have a few items that we need to take care of in the next couple of days. We will have the report that we will make to the events committee. Michael is thankfully nodding his head because I know he's been taking minutes and keeping notes on this, and he will work with me to get our report for the events committee, and then in particular the match race ranking recommendation. We need to put that forward, and then also the Nations Cup recommendation to put forward the activities that we want to have continued. Sarah Kinney, as the chair of the events committee, has been very helpful in carrying forward any recommendations we make to the events committee. So I expect that will carry on as well for this next meeting of the events committee. So is there anything else anyone else would like to bring up before we close this?
Well, just to joining with Michael's comment, and I think I'm speaking for all of us, that you have really done a humongous work with a great heart, Liz, in guiding us through many years, and also bringing out the best in all of us in the committee. And therefore, so thank you for sharing your knowledge, your wisdom, and it's been a pleasure to work together with you.
The same for me, Liz. Thank you very much.
You're blushing.
I'm happy to work with you last 12 years. It's really, really a great time. Great. Thank you very much, Liz, for everything.
Thank you, Jana and Michael. And thank you for all the time you've put in as well. All of you have been very strong and very supportive. Thank you. I heard someone else's voice a moment ago.
Yeah, that was me. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, so whilst you're getting all these compliments, I thought I might as well pipe in as well there, Liz. It seems a bit strange me saying thank you because I'm the new boy in town, but you know, I do know your reputation and I've worked with you previously in the past, and World Sailing having such a luminaire in women's sailing leading this subcommittee is really fantastic. So you know, on behalf of World Sailing, I would also like to thank you for volunteering your time. Indeed, thank all of the committee members. I've listened intently over the last few hours, taken some notes that I'll take back and chat with Pedro and Alistair about, but I just wanted to thank you all for your great work. And I know we haven't met yet, as I said at the beginning, but my door, whether it be the physical door or virtual door, is always open. So if there's anything that I can do, you know how to get hold of me. And thanks again to everybody for all of your great work.
Great. Thank you, David. And I hope, well, the next 4 months, we continue to work together. And then after that, when the new chair takes on and the new subcommittee, that they will continue to bang on your door. Maybe not knock gently, but hopefully make a loud noise and keep things going.
Judging by my first 3 months, I've got to get through the next 4 months.
Yeah, it's been
anyway,
a
that's
tough
another
one.
Story.
Great. Thank you, David. And thank you for the support from you and your staff on keeping things going and being very supportive and coming up with unique solutions to difficult problems.
Okay, well, that's our job. Thank you. Goodbye, all.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you, David. Okay, I think if there's no one else to make comments, then I will adjourn this meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Liz.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Liz.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. See you soon, hopefully.
Thank you, Pedro.
Thank you, Pedro.
Thank you, Pedro.
And bye-bye.
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 Thank you.
Thank you, Massimo.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone.
See you online soon.
Morning.